Day to all the dads out there. Let's put those hands together and let's praise our Heavenly Father this morning.
You, Lord, I'll pray.
sets free is free indeed. Whom the sun sets free has liberty. Your love has taken chains off me. Whose chains are off this morning? Whom the sun sets free is free indeed. Whom the sun sets free has liberty. Your love has taken chains off me. Whom the sun sets free, yeah.
Sun sets free is free
indeed. Whom the sun sets free has liberty.
Your love has taken chains off me.
Yeah. Oh, whom the sun sets free is free.
Father, we just thank you and we praise you regardless of our circumstances, Father, whether in need or in want or in plenty.
I count on one thing, the same God that never fails will not fail me now. You won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God who's never late is working all things out. You're working all things out.
Yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. Oh, yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy.
Glorify the name of all names.
Yes, I will glorify, praise your name. So let's do that this morning. Amen.
You have given me a reason, so I'm singing my praise unto you. You have lifted every burden, so I'm singing my praise unto you. It's a brand new day,
it's a brand new day,
so I give you praise,
give you praise.
All for you, Lord, it's all for you. You're the reason that I lift my voice and give you praise. Lord, I give you praise for the things you do, 'cause there's nobody like you, you, you. There's nobody like you, you, you. There's nobody like you. You got me singing and rejoicing, overflowing with praise unto you.
Now
I'm living in your freedom,
overflowing
with praise unto you.
Importantly, we have a Heavenly Father that loves us unconditionally. Has God been good to anybody in this place today? I'll ask this side right here. Has God been good to anybody in this house today? So can we just take the next 30 seconds and give Him praise as Laura leads us? Come on, let's give Him praise.
All for You, Lord, it's all for You. You're the reason that I lift my voice and give You praise.
Lord, I give You praise.
Time, put those hands together. Oh, it's gonna get good in here. Come on, let's give Him praise. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Come on, this is one of those churches where we celebrate God, where we honor Him, where we praise Him. We're not afraid to give Him glory and give Him honor because it all belongs to Him anyway. Amen. Do me a favor, before you're seated, turn around and tell three people you're the man. Would you do that right now? On behalf of Father's Day, come on, just tell them you're the man. Our ushers are coming, and we're going to continue to worship the Lord in giving. And while they're preparing and making their way here, I just want to just share a bit of good news with you today. We have waived all of our contingencies upon the building at Brentmore. Amen. We feel comfortable with that. And so this Tuesday afternoon, we will be at the bank signing papers and officially making the old Brentmore Elementary School the future home of Life Point Church. Come on, let's give God praise. Amen. And so we still got a lot of work to do, but we're taking it one step at a time, one hurdle at a time. And just again, was over there this past week. It's going to be a great place to glorify God, to magnify God, and to make a difference in our community. And 7.5 wonderful acres where kids will still be able to come and enjoy the park and the ball fields and all of those things. So we're going to use the building as a vehicle, right? We're the church. Hello? We, this body, is the church. These are vehicles in which God uses to bring about his purpose. And so it's just the vehicle, and we're going to give God all the praise and glory for it. It's your dedication and your commitment to continue to give that enables us to take the next step here at Life Point Church. So over the past, I don't know, 3, 4, 5 years, we have raised somewhere around $362,000, $365,000. They're going to help us go towards the building, so we give God glory for that. So anyhow, still got a long way to go. But we know God's going to help us. So your tithe and offering, well, it's his tithe, it's his offering, but your being willing to give helps us reach one life at a time. Amen. So, Father, we thank you and we praise you for this opportunity to give. We thank you for opening up the door. Lord, we thank you, God, for continuing to lead us on this journey. And, Lord, we'll never cease to give you the praise nor glory for it. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. And everyone said, amen. Go ahead, ushers. We have a video and then we'll be right back.
Good morning, Life Point Church fans, and welcome. If this is your first time here, we want to say thank you so much for joining. Make sure you stop at Life Point Central and fill out a connection card. We'll also give you a free gift on Life Point Church. Ooh. David, today is a big day at Life Point. Why don't you tell the viewers what's going on?
It is indeed. It is Father's Day for all you fathers out there, so make sure you stick around after the service. We're going to be brying. We're going to be sizzling up some boerewors, maybe some chicken necks, things like that. It's going to be lovely, so stick around.
And for us Americans out there, that means that we're just going to have some barbecue after the church. We're going to be grilling hot dogs and all hanging out in support of our lovely fathers.
Thank you for translating, Morgan.
You're welcome, David. Now, speaking to all of our fathers out there, if you have not gotten a raffle ticket to be entered to win 2 Browns preseason tickets, make sure you do so, because we are giving away 2 preseason tickets to the Browns game. Now, if you win, make sure that you don't bring my dad, Pastor Ken Wright, because you might see a side of him that you really don't want to see. Coming up, we have our graduation celebration. Moving on up is happening June 30th at 11:15. So if you know anybody that's graduating high school or college or even moving up classes at Life Point Church, make sure you see someone at Life Point Central, fill out all the information sheet so that we can celebrate you on your big day. Now, there's going to be lots going on that day. They're going to do a little performance for us, so you are in for a treat. It's going to be fun, fun, fun. So, David, why don't you tell our viewers now about VBS coming up?
VBS, the Visual Band-Aid School.
That's not what it stands for.
Oh, the Vacation Bible School. That's happening in December.
It's not in December.
For all the old...
It's not in December.
I knew about this. The Vacation Bible School is happening on the 15th to the 19th of July. That's happening at 6 to 8 p.m. right here at Mena High School, and it's ages 3 to 5th grade. The theme is Power Up, connecting kids through a culturally relevant video game theme.
Yeah, it's going to be a lot of fun for all you kids out there. It's going to be a blast. We're going to have lots of things for them to do, but we also need some volunteers for our VBS. So if you know anybody or you yourself want to volunteer, you can do that as well at Life Point Central. Okay, well, that's all the announcements that we have for you today. Again, we want to wish you a happy... Father's Day. And stick around after church. We'll see you at the barbecue, not the
bride. No, we're brine, everybody. It's not a barbecue.
Okay, we just...
Happy Father's Day.
Welcome, LifePoint. We are so excited to celebrate our dads this morning with our kids. So we have our preschoolers coming up here on the stage.
Let's get ready to rumble!
We also have some of our preschool dads that have offered to do a tug of war against these preschoolers. So while they get set up, these preschools need to hear you guys cheer them on. So I want to hear it. Let's go preschool!
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 Let's go preschool! Let's go preschool!
All right, and I think our dads might need a little help today as well. So let's go, dads!
Let's go, dads!
Let's go, dads!
Let's go, dads!
Let's go, dads! All right, guys, are we ready, preschoolers? Dads, are we ready? All right, well, we know the rule. The first team to pull the bandana past their line is the winning team. All right, are we ready? 3, 2, 1, pull! Let's cheer them on, come on!
Hey, good job, dads. Good job, dads. Good effort.
All right. We have a very special guest that is going to be coming up on stage with us. Before I hand the mic off to him, if there are any dads out there that have not received their ticket to get entered into a drawing for a preseason game, please raise your hand and the ushers will come around to go ahead and give that to you. I see a few hands over here. Let's hear it up for Jason.
Good morning, LifePoint Church. That was fun. I got throat burns from that. So, all the fathers in here, raise your hand if you do not have a red ticket yet. We need a red ticket for all the fathers. So the drawing is for a pair of Cleveland Browns tickets. The Browns have not issued their tickets yet, but this is a coupon for it, so make sure you give your information to the church office, find Marisa, and we'll make sure you guys get the tickets when it's time. But before I do, we have something that Grace would love to say.
Here we go, Brownies, here we go. Woof, woof.
All right, well done, well done. Everybody's in here? All right, Grace, can you do me a favor and pull out a winning dad ticket?
Yeah.
The winning number is?
2, 2, 7.
Does anybody have two? Oh, wait, we have more numbers.
2, 2, 7, 1, 6, 6.
Mr. Jason. So the fun does not stop there. We have our Kids Church kids and some of their dads coming out as well for a hot dog eating contest. Because what do dads love more than hot dogs and eating, right? So let's give a round of applause for our Kids Church kids and our very brave dads. So each team is going to get two hot dogs, chips, and a water. The first team to finish their two hot dogs, their chips in their water is the winning team. All right, dads and kids, you understand that you don't each have to eat a hot dog, right? There might be some strategy in this. And I also already heard Craig, he's not holding back. He told us he's not holding back. So, other dads, you better be ready. Okay. Dads, are we ready? Ready? Kids, thumbs up if you're ready. All right. I'm going to count down from three, and it's time to eat. 3, 2, 1, eat! Come on, crowd, let's cheer them on!
$1 billion. The question is, who let the dogs out?
Come on.
You guys are doing great!
Tyson's
who
early
let
lead.
The dogs out?
Who let the dogs out?
I feel like I just let the air out of the balloon. Amen. Hey, let's give our dads a hand. Wow. And should have been in the 9:30 service. It's always good to have hot dogs for breakfast. Amen. All right. Kevin, you won the ticket? Our tickets? All right. Let me tell you, those are great seats. I've sat in those seats. You are at the 40-yard line visitor side, about 10 rows back from the bench. So you can even yell and the players can hear you if you want to get on somebody. I wouldn't know anybody who would do that. But anyhow, I don't know where Morgan came up with that. But so you're going to really, really enjoy those tickets. And a big shout out to Jason and Amber for giving up those tickets. Two in the first service, two here. And a big shout out to them for donating those tickets. You're going to have a great, great time. All right. How many of you know that God, our Heavenly Father, likes to have us to have fun as well? Come on, He's not some killjoy, right? God's not up there with this big hammer, you know, waiting for us to, you know, goof off or mess up and whack us one. No, God is a loving, caring, generous, fun, amen. God that we serve. He's our Heavenly Father, and we honor Him and we celebrate Him today. Wow, I mean, the first service, somebody's like, what happened? I can't explain it. I really can't. The presence of God just settled in this room, quite frankly, in a way that I have not experienced in a very, very long time. And God just began to speak to us and to encourage us and to just let us know that He loves us unconditionally, He's for us, that He plans to prosper us. And there were just a lot of people in the room that God really, really touched. And weights were lifted, burdens were lifted, anxiety and fear and all of those things just began to dissipate in the presence of God. And, you know, so there is a bit of an overflow from that here right now as we shift gears into this part of the service. And someone said, well, I hope that happens in the second service. And I said, well, me too. But, you know, God never duplicates. That's why there's no person on this earth like you. He never duplicates anything. He originates, right? So He originates everything. And so I don't know what God's going to do, but this is what I do know. The same God who knew every need in the first service is the same God who knows every need in this service. And He can meet those needs. And Beth, I'm so glad you're here today. And we prayed for you. We prayed for that precious baby. I keep wanting to call her Natalie, and I know that's Natalia. I know. Okay, some of you haven't heard. Gave birth a couple last week, and the doctor found a tumor. It's cancerous, and it's on the jawbone. And they started treatments yesterday. I think there's 18 chemo treatments that this precious gift that God has given us is going through right now. And just to you know, try to get a plan together, try to get a strategy together to bring healing. Now, here's what I do know. I thank God for doctors. I thank God that we're able to go to a place like Rainbows and have the care that is provided. But when the doctors come to their end, God's not through. Amen? God's not through. And so the initial shock is always fear. I don't care. When you receive news like that, the initial shock is always fear. I don't care who you are. But then at some point in time, faith begins to stand up on the inside of us. And then we begin to stand upon the word of the living God. And then we begin to let the enemy know that no weapon formed against us is ever going to prosper. It's just not going to happen. So I'm just going to take a few moments, and she's not asked me to do this, and I think she probably just wanted to come in here and settle in and just get in the presence of the Lord. But I want everybody to stand, and Beth, if you'll come. Prayer team, Barb, come on, hurry, please. Is there a prayer cloth around here somewhere somebody can help me with? Will you bring that for me? Now, if this was your baby and this was your newborn, you would want everybody in this room and all around the world who believes in healing for God to bring that miraculous touch. So come on in here, hon. Now, this is what God says in His word, that they brought handkerchiefs and aprons to the Apostle Paul, and he prayed over them. It's in Acts chapter 19, I believe. And he prayed over them, and the Bible said that people were healed and people were delivered and people were set free. Whoever came in contact with the prayer cloth. Now, there's nothing magical about this prayer cloth. Or there's no magic thing in this. But this prayer cloth represents a point of contact. It's a point where we can attach our faith to it. And so this prayer cloth we're going to anoint and pray over. And we're going to take this, and wherever the baby is, this prayer cloth is going to be attached as a point of contact that God is a healing God. I told you the initial thought when you receive news like this is fear. But now faith is starting to kick in, and now family is starting to come into agreement. For if any two or three of us gather together in His name will touch and agree, believing, it shall be done for them. So I've moved beyond one point, and I'm in a new point, and I'm just mad right now. And because the devil is a liar, and God has given us a precious gift who's made in His image and His likeness. So, Father, right now we come to You in the mighty, mighty name of Jesus, and we lift Your precious child up before You, Lord, formed in Your image and likeness. Touch her, Lord, even now as we stand here by faith believing, You, God, are able to dissolve this tumor. I pray, God, right now, as every person in this room is praying and lifting up their voice to You, God, I pray right now, God, that You would begin to reverse this, astound and amaze the doctors. We speak life and wholeness and wellness. Lord, we speak victory. We decree that by Your stripes, she is healed. And You sent Your word and healed every disease and every sickness. Now we plead the blood, and we cover her in the blood right now. We put a blood covering and a blood line. Devil, thus far and no more. Take your hands and your weapons and flee in Jesus' name. For no weapon formed against us will prosper. And when that devil comes in like a flood, the Spirit of the Lord raises up a standard against him. So, Lord, we move now into the realm of faith and trust believing and decreeing. We decree from this moment on that she is healed, that she is whole, and Lord, that her purpose in which You created her for will be fulfilled on this earth, and she will praise You all the days of her life. We stand in agreement for the miracle working power of God to begin to manifest. It's in Jesus' mighty name we pray. Father, touch Beth, touch David, touch this family. Give them supernatural strength, strength from another world. Faith to rise, peace that surpasses all understanding, joy unspeakable and full of glory, and we'll never cease to give You the praise or the glory for it. In Jesus' mighty name we pray, amen and amen. I want you to take that. Amen. I want to know how many people for the next 7 days will take time to pray and fast. How many people for the next 7 days will take time to pray and fast? Maybe you'll fast breakfast, lunch, a meal. Maybe you'll fast some social media or something where you're going to take that time. You're going to get with God. All right, everybody who will do that, let me see. Now, Beth, turn around. I want you to see what's happening right here. These hands that are lifted today, we are with you. You're not fighting this alone. We are with you. And whatever this family needs, I want you to know that your family right here is here to help you in Jesus' name. We're going to pray, we're going to fast, and God is going to bring the victory in Jesus' name. Come on, church. Hey, can we just go ahead and praise God like it's already done? I said, take the next 30 seconds and praise God like it's already done. Amen. Hey, before you're seated, turn to three people just by the word of a testimony and just say, He already did it. He's done it. Come on, tell him. It's done. It's done. It's done. It's done. He did it. Didn't He do it? First Kings chapter 19. 1 Kings chapter 19, Now, in the first service, all I was able to do was read this scripture. And we didn't get past that. It's been an unusual day, but it's been a good day. The Spirit of the Lord is in this house. Hello? The Spirit of the Lord is in this place. What does that mean? It simply means this. The Bible said wherever Jesus was, the Spirit of the Lord was present to heal. Wherever Jesus was, wherever he ministered, the Spirit of God was there to bring life, to bring hope, to bring wellness. Well, that Spirit, his Spirit, is not diminished. The same Spirit that was healing people as Jesus walked the earth, the Holy Spirit, is here today. He's able. Amen? We're not fighting for victory. We're fighting from the place of victory. We're not fighting for healing. We're fighting from the place of healing in his name. Amen. I'm just mad at the devil. I really am. Sometimes we gotta get to that place where we say, enough, devil. Especially in a world today where half the church doesn't even believe in a literal devil. There is a devil. He's a fallen angel, but he's also defeated in Jesus' name, right? He's defeated in Jesus' name. I don't know. I'm going to try to do this again, but wherever God takes us, that's where we'll go. 1 Kings chapter number 19, speaking about the prophet Elijah. Then he lay down under the bush and fell asleep. And all at once, an angel touched him. Many scholars believe that this is the pre-incarnate Christ. In the Old Testament, you'll read about times where the angel of the Lord appeared. Literally Jesus. He touched him and said, "Get up and eat." And he looked around, and there was by his head was some bread baked over hot coals in a jar of water. He ate and he drank, then he lay down again. Then the angel of the Lord came back a second time and touched him. I want you to know, if you don't get it on the first time, God's coming back again. He will keep coming and coming and coming and coming until we get up. He touched him and said, "Get up and eat, for the journey is too much for you." So he got up and he ate and he drank, strengthened by that food. He traveled 40 days and 40 nights until he reached Horeb, the mountain of God. There he went into a cave and spent the night. And the word of the Lord came to him, "What are you doing here, Elijah?" Elijah replied, "I have been very zealous for the Lord God Almighty. The Israelites have rejected your covenant, tore down your altars, put the prophets to death with the sword, and I'm the only one left. Now they're trying to kill me." Then the Lord said to him, "Go out and stand on the mountain in the presence of the Lord, for the Lord is about to pass by." How many of you know God's getting ready? God's getting ready to pass by. In other words, God's getting ready to move in your situation. Then a great and powerful wind tore the mountains apart and shattered the rocks before the Lord, but the Lord was not in the wind. And after the wind, there was an earthquake. Anybody feel the earthquake on Tuesday? I just thought another tree fell in my yard, but anyhow. But the Lord was not in the earthquake. And after the earthquake came a fire, but the Lord was not in the fire. And after the fire came that a gentle whisper. When Elijah heard it, pulled the cloak over his face. He went out and stood on the mouth of the cave, and the voice said to him second time, "What are you doing here?" What are you doing here? Father, in the mighty name of Jesus, I thank you, Lord, for everything you've already done in this house. And I know you're not done. And I pray, God, that you would continue to speak and minister to all of us today. We need you, Lord. We need you, Lord. There are people under the sound of my voice, Lord. They've been through the fire. They've been through the shaking. They've been through the storms. Lord, they've battled and they battled. And Lord, they need to hear from you today. And I know that you're going to speak to them in that still small voice. I know you're going to minister to them today, Father. We'll never cease to give you the praise nor the glory for it. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. And everyone said, amen. Thank you, Jim. He worked overtime today in that first service, played the whole service, so he needs a break. I want us to look at three things today as we continue to track the story of Elijah and his wilderness journey that led him to the cave. Those three things are simply this. I want us to look at our assignment. I want us to look at our opposition. And then I want us to look at the cause of withdrawal. Our assignment, our opposition, and then I want us to look at the cause of our withdrawal. Whether you realize this or not, every person on this people planet has an assignment from God. If you have a pulse, you have a purpose. It's only when you come into a born-again experience with God that you begin to discover the purpose that God has for your life. Now, one of the things that we have to understand is simply this. God decides or determines what that assignment is going to be. He told the prophet Jeremiah, he said, before I formed you in your mother's womb, I called you to be a prophet to the nations. And so God decides what that assignment, and all of us have one, what that assignment is going to be. Therefore, if you don't know God, if you're not in relationship with God, then you do not know or can't really fully understand the will or the purpose that He has for your life. It's only after you surrender your life, your will to Him, that you begin to discover the assignment that God has for your life. There are several clues that will help you understand what that assignment is. You may want to jot these things down, or maybe we can post them later. I don't have them on the screen for you, but a couple of things that will help you discover what God's assignment for your life really is. One of the things that you might want to ask yourself is, what am I passionate about? Because whatever you're passionate about, you're going to pursue. As a matter of fact, I can tell what someone's passionate about by just watching them pursue. Because whatever they're pursuing, that's what they're passionate about. Another thing you may want to ask yourself is, what do you just love to do? What do you really love to do? Another question you might want to ask yourself is, what brings joy to my life? What really brings joy to my life? Another thing you may want to jot down is, what do I notice? I kid about this because half the congregation are hairstylists. What do you call them? Beauticians, yeah. And so half my day is spent, my wife, my daughter, and you know, a couple of you in here, Beth, all of you. I mean, how many of you do hair? Let me see your hands. Yeah, Sherry, okay, all right, here we go. What do you notice?
Hair.
You notice good haircuts and bad haircuts. So what do you notice? It's an indicator of your assignment. What sparks your creativity? What gets those creative juices flowing in your life? These are all insights on the assignment that God has for your life. What do people compliment you on? What do they compliment you about? Another thing, what would you do if you knew you couldn't fail? What would you do if you knew you couldn't fail? All of those things, and if you begin to search out and answer those questions, these are indicators, signs, if you will, of the assignment that God has for your life. Got to hurry up. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 10 says this, "For we are God's masterpiece. He has created us anew in Christ." This is where you begin to discover this. "In Christ Jesus." Why? "So that we can do," look at this, "we can do the good things He planned for us long ago, in eternity past, so that we can do the things that God has predestined for us to do." God says that we are a masterpiece. If you don't get anything else today, take that home with you. You are God's masterpiece. Because you may be sitting here today or watching us online, and you may think somebody told you a time or two ago that you were a mistake. There are no mistakes in this room. There are no mistakes on this earth. We are all God's masterpiece. Here's the great thing about God, too, because God sees beyond our mess. We're not a mess. God sees beyond that. God just doesn't see our sin. He just doesn't see the mistakes that we've made, the failures that we have, or the mess. God sees us as His masterpiece. Now, the word masterpiece here in this particular scripture, it's a little bit difficult for us to translate, but the Greek word, when you translate it, is, I think I'm pronouncing this right, poimenia. It's where we get the word poem from. And it literally means a made thing or workmanship. We are God's workmanship. In other words, God is working on us. Come on, look at your neighbor and tell him, "I'm not a finished product. Don't judge me right now. God's not through with me. But when God's through with me, I am and will be His masterpiece." So you cannot just look at a person now. You have to understand that God is molding them. God is shaping them. God is moving edges off of them and creating soft places in their life. God is just molding them into His image and His likeness so that we can carry out His purpose on this earth. And then He says this. He says that you and I were created in Christ to do good works. We are here to glorify and to magnify our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And one of the ways that we do that is through good things or service. The Bible says in Acts 10:38 that God anointed Jesus, and this is what He did. He went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed or depressed by and of the devil. So God anoints us to go about doing good, healing all who are sick and oppressed, and God using us to bring about His purpose for our lives. God created you and I to accomplish His purpose for our life. In other words, you and I are designed for an assignment. How many of you believe that right now? So before you were ever even born, God decided your purpose. Do you realize that before this microphone was built, it already had a purpose? The purpose of this microphone was to amplify my voice, although I don't need it. It helps in times. But the purpose of this microphone is to amplify my voice. And the purpose was already there before this mic was even built. And the same goes for us. In other words, God had a purpose for you before He created you. God already has your purpose in mind. That's why I just said a minute ago that God decides, you discover. It's up to us to discover what that purpose is. I gave you a couple of keys to help you that way, but we'll just add to that. One of the things as you begin to discover your assignment is this. You will discover that your assignment is always connected to people. Look at the person beside you and say, "I'm connected to you." God's assignment is always connected to people. Let me give you an example. If you're Moses, you're assigned to the people of Israel. Your assignment is to deliver them from bondage, take it a step down. If you're Joshua, your assignment is to serve Moses. And if God can find you faithful in serving, then he's going to use you to usher people into the promised land. Because it was Joshua and Caleb that ushered them into the promised land. If you're the Apostle Paul, then your assignment is to the Gentiles. If you're the Apostle Peter, then you are assigned to the Jews. Every believer on this planet has an assignment, and your assignment is connected to people. And one of the ways that God grows your assignment, one of the ways that God develops your plan or his assignment in your life is God plants you in a church. Paul said it in Corinthians that God sets the members in the body as he wills. So let me just say this to you right now. You just didn't stumble up here at Lake Erie Church. I'm not there anymore, am I? Lord Jesus, help me. That was 20 years ago. Props out to Lake Erie. We love you. Where am I at? Life Point. I wonder if I just stumbled into here. You're not here by accident. If you're led by the Spirit of God, which I believe you are, then God says your assignment is here, connected to a body that's called Life Point Church, which represents the body of Christ. So God put you in this local assembly so that he could connect you with people of like faith, so that he could develop the gift and the calling and the purpose that he has for your life. 1 Peter 4 and 10 says this, that each of us should use whatever gift God has given us, whatever we have received from him, so that we can serve others. So God did not gift you so that you could just serve yourself. God gifted you, God anointed you, God has assigned you with a person in mind, with a people in mind. And God wants you to use that gift and use that talent to serve others, to bring glory and honor unto him. Our gift, our assignment is not centered on self. The assignment is centered on others. Didn't Jesus himself say in Mark 10, 45, he said, I didn't come to be served. I came to serve. I came to serve people. I came to serve and lead them into the saving knowledge. Church, our job is to serve people so that we can lead them to the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. That's why every act of service is vital to the development of your purpose. That's why you should never, ever look at service as insignificant. Can I talk about it? Because it really doesn't matter. It really doesn't matter what the assignment is initially. Listen to me. I didn't start up here. I didn't start up here. I felt the call 2 weeks after I was saved. I didn't know what it was. It was later, as God began to reveal that to me, I felt that call. God confirmed that call to pastor, but I didn't start pastoring. I started serving. Ah, almost cussed right there, didn't I? And I can tell you right now, I can say this, that I think that I have held every position that a church has to offer. I really do. I don't think there's anything in church any area in church that I'm aware of and this is not, oh, look at me. I'm just trying to get you to see how God moves you along. Hey, guess what? I've been in nursery. I can tell you I'm not called to nursery. God bless our nursery team. Come on, give it up for them. But I'm not called to nursery. I worked in the boys' clubs. So I can tell you right now, those little guys can be tough. I've cleaned, I've mowed the grass. I mean, there's not one area in the church that I've not served in. I think one of the most profound statements that I've heard in a long time came from Dave a couple of months ago. And Dave's here somewhere working on something, I can guarantee you that. And we were talking and Dave said, you know what, Pastor? He said, I'm not called to set up. Don't get quiet in here right now. He said, I'm not called to set up. You know, we go through these spiritual gift tests and we do all these things. And, well, that's not my calling. I'm not called to be on the setup team. He said, I'm not called to set up. And he said, let me tell you what I am called to do. I'm called to serve. He said, I am called to serve. And every single one of us are what? All of us are called to serve. And guess what? God watches how we serve. God pays attention to how we serve. And if God finds us faithful, he promotes us. Amen. From assignment to assignment to assignment until he gets you to really where he really wants you to be. So wherever you're at, you need to find some people and you need to find a place and you need to raise your hand and say, what do you want me to do? I figured I'd get an amen somewhere out of that. What do you want me to do? Why? Because you have an assignment by God. And it's vital that you catch that assignment. Start serving. When you start serving, God will say, okay, boom, boom, boom. And before you know it, you'll be in the purpose that God has called or anointed you for your life to carry out. God calls you to serve him by reaching out and touching others around you. So because I have an assignment, I got to hurry, I'm sorry. Because I have an assignment, I have an adversary. Okay? This is why we shouldn't think it strange when we have opposition. As a matter of fact, if you don't have opposition, then you're not doing your assignment. If you're doing your assignment, you're going to have opposition. Because you have an adversary, the Bible says, an opponent who is in opposition to that assignment. Here's what it is. 1 Peter 5:8 says this. Be careful. Watch out for attacks from Satan, your great enemy. Notice it's not God's enemy because God has no rival. There's no equal to him. I know we just had a tug of war up here and sometimes people think in their minds that, you know, God's on this end and the devil's on that end and they're having this tug of war. And one day God wins and the next day the enemy's winning. That's not true. The devil's no match for God. As a matter of fact, if you really want to understand and know what happened to the devil, Lucifer, how God created him, he said, I'm going to rise above God. I'm going to put my throne above God. And God said, no, you're not. And Jesus said it was like lightning. It was that quick. God just kicked him out of heaven. No wrestling match, no struggle. God just kicked him out. I'm telling you right now, the devil is no match for the God that you and I serve. The devil is not God's adversary. He's our adversary, but not God's adversary. But this is what he says. He says he prowls around like a hungry, roaring lion, seeking for some victim to tear apart. You have opposition. There's an enemy after us, hates us. His plan is to devour us. Notice the scripture says that we are to be aware, that we are to be on guard against spiritual attacks. You have to be ready because your enemy, and every one of us have one, is looking for an opportunity to do what? To remove you from your assignment. That's what he's looking to do. I know the Bible says he comes to steal, kill, and destroy. Ultimately, he wants to take as many people to hell with him. But there are people under the sound of my voice that hell is no longer an option. In other words, you've done decided. This is the line. I crossed the line, and I'm not going back. So backsliding or going back is not an option for you. And the devil knows that you're not going to go back into his camp. So he's going to do everything that he can to try to get you to knock you off or out of the assignment that God has for your life. That's why all of these attacks and all of these distractions come your way. Sometimes it's not this onslaught of one thing after the other that's trying to remove you from the assignment that God has for your life. Sometimes it's just distractions. In other words, we get too busy doing things that God's not called us to do, that God is not asking us to do, and the enemy knows if I can keep them busy, I can deter them from the assignment that God has for your life. Woo! So he brings distractions in our life. And you have to filter through those distractions. You have to say, this is not of God, this is not from God. And you just have to get through all of that stuff. Yes to this, no to that. So that you don't get so bogged down that you're not doing what God has called you to do. He's looking for a way to just move us away from our assignment. Now, this is what happened with Elijah. He's withdrawn from his assignment. Now, listen to me, church. There are serious consequences from withdrawing from your assignment. This is important. Because the person or the people that God has called you to serve, if you withdraw from your assignment, if you withdraw from what God has called you to do, then you are now the missing link between that person and God. So you have to make sure that you understand who you are called to, what you are called to do, and never ever surrender the assignment that God has for your life. Someone said one time, and they said that it takes 88 different people in order for someone, in other words, 88 people that are speaking and ministering and sowing into your life for you to come to the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. 88 links in the chain. And so who knows if you're that middle link in that chain? That if you drop your assignment, if you quit doing what God's called you to do, who knows if you're that link that's going to call someone to miss out on hearing or receiving an opportunity to receive God. That's how vital, that's how important this assignment really is. What if all of us just decided one day, I'm not going to do what God's called me to do anymore? How many people would be affected by that? What if all of us just said, you know what, I don't feel like it today? Oh, it's quiet in this. I'm coming for you today. This is how vital it is. This is how important it is. Because if God has positioned you in the community and called you to serve and you withdraw from that call, it's going to take a long time to reroute someone to fulfill the call that God has on your life. And I argue the fact that I don't believe they can be as effective as you, because originally it was God who called you to do it. I didn't say it couldn't be done. But I wonder how effective it can be and how much a delay takes place because we're that missing link. Listen to me. It's not always obvious when someone withdraws. You can be in a marriage and be withdrawn. You can be in a church and be withdrawn. You can be in a relationship with Jesus and be withdrawn. It's a matter of the heart. It has to do with withdrawing from meaningful connections in your life. Watch this. Since it's Dad's Day, I'll talk about this. It's not beating up on guys, but it's just a point. As a husband, as a father, our responsibility is to pray and cover our family. Come on, dads, help me. We're the priest of our home. So our responsibility is to pray and cover our family. When we don't pray, we leave our family uncovered. And when we leave them uncovered, we now face unnecessary pressures, unnecessary attacks. Because if we would have held our place, held our position, and continued to pray, the enemy would not have gained space or access into that area of our family if we would have prayed that hedge around our family. Do you understand what I'm talking about? Right? So when you and I withdraw from our place, it opens space for our adversary to operate in. This is why it's also vital for us to hold our place. So God connects you to people, and God connects you to a place so that your assignment can be carried out. God connects you to people, and God connects you to a place. Let's take it this way. So that workplace you're in, and you're thinking, I need to get out of this place. I'm the only saved person in this place. Anybody ever feel that way? I'm going to help you. I mean, I every time I go there, I feel like, oh my gosh, let me help you. If you're the only believer there, you're supposed to be there. Because you have a congregation of unbelievers. You have a church of non-believers. If they're ever going to come to the saving knowledge, they're probably not going to show up here and hear me. But they're going to see you. And they're going to hear you. And they're going to watch you. And they're going to notice you. And they're going to see you being different. So let me just give you a little help here to help you change the atmosphere of your workplace. Why don't you pray before you get there? I figured I'd get an amen somewhere. Amen. Why don't you pray on the way there? Father God, I cover that area. I cover that place. I cover this place where we're working. And I know they're all heathens, God. And sometimes I want to send... No, sometimes. I should tell the story, but I won't. Some of you are like, tell it. No, I can't. I don't have permission. I won't. I don't know if I can remember the story. And it'll totally throw me off. Then why did I open my mouth? Because you're not going to hear anything else now the rest of the day. I would tell you if I could remember it, but I can't remember all of it. Oh, Lord, help him. I'm just trying to get you to see that God put you there for a reason. Now pray. Pray. You can change that whole atmosphere. You can affect the whole environment just by simply covering it in prayer. And when you get in there and things start going crazy, don't you go crazy. When they're talking about everyone else, don't you start talking about them. Stand your ground, and there'll come a time and there'll come an opportunity where one of them will come to you and they'll say, I noticed you didn't say anything about this. Or I noticed you walked away when this was taking place. Why? That's your open door. That's your opportunity, right? God's assigned you there. God's placed you there to make a difference. And God knows that you can do it if you'll just trust and believe in him and be prayed up and ready to walk through that door when God opens it, right? God has connected you to people, and not all of them are in the church. Ooh, help us, Jesus. One of the ways that you can tell that someone is withdrawing is they neglect their responsibilities. I say this all the time. They check out mentally before they check out physically. I mean, they're there, but they're not there. That's the first thing. Mentally, they just check out. I'm done. I'm through. I'm over. And I may be here, but I'm not here. The second thing and that helps you identify someone who is withdrawing is this. They withdraw from meaningful relationships, and they begin to isolate themselves. So you know what they do? They stop attending life group. Where's all my life group leaders? I should have had an amen right there. That's your place to connect. It's your place to grow. It's where discipleship happens. We were just in our life group on Friday night. By the way, our life group, we go out to eat. Anybody like to eat? You can be part of our group. But it's more than just eating. We're developing relationships. We're connecting with each other. And you know what? There's going to come a time when we're going to need someone in that group. We're going to need to talk to somebody. And you've already developed that relationship with them. And God gives you those connections for a reason. But you'll notice when people, they'll start isolating themselves. They'll start withdrawing from meaningful relationships. They no longer connect in a church service. Oh, they're here, but they're not connected. They don't engage in worship. And the reason that they don't engage in worship is because they don't feel comfortable anymore, because they have withdrawn themselves from the body. Do you realize that one of the characteristics of sheep, which we are compared to, by the way, one of the characteristics of sheep when they get sick or wounded is they stray away from the flock and they isolate themselves? And when we feel like we want to withdraw because of pain, because of shame, because of fear, be careful. Be careful with isolation and be careful with separation, because how many of you know that's what that roaring lion is waiting on? He's waiting for you to break the pack. He's waiting for you to separate. He's waiting for you to isolate, because if he can get you alone, if he can get you away from the flock, if he can get you by the self, you are now easy prey for him. Just nudge your neighbor and tell him, stay connected. Stay connected. Listen to me. It's easy to discern when you're in a cave, because people that are in a spiritual cave are hiding away from connection. I promise I'm almost done. You're hiding from connection with God, and you're hiding from connection with people. You're drawn away from your assignment. And this is your attitude. Listen, I've been there, so I'm preaching from experience right now. This is your attitude. Just leave me alone. Don't bother me. Now, none of you guys have ever been there, but just pretend you have. I don't want to do that anymore. I'm okay. Just don't sign me. I don't want to do it. Just leave me alone. That is an indicator that you have withdrawn yourself from your assignment and the connections that God has for your life. And by the way, this is exactly where Elijah's at in his life. This is where he's at. He's withdrawn from his assignment. He's disconnected from God, and he's disconnected from people, because the Bible said this about him. The Bible said that he left his servant in the wilderness, and he himself went another day's journey to get to this point. So he has disconnected himself from everyone whom God has placed in his life. And this is dangerous. And it's dangerous because over time, if you disconnect, you will choke the voices out that are assigned to speak into your life. Because just as your assignment is connected to people, guess what? God has assigned someone to you. Hello? Your assignment is to people, but God has someone assigned to you. Nobody does this alone. It's not good for man to be alone. God never called us to do life alone. He designed it and created it in a way, and in its highest context is in the form of marriage, but that's not limited to marriage. It's limited to relationships in which God brings into our lives. And part of the responsibility to the people that are assigned to your life are to help you. Quit pushing away your help. Amen. Quit walking away from your help. That help may very well be the voice of reason in your life at that period in your life. Because when you're going through it, the storms, the struggles, the battles, it's hard to have a proper perspective. That's why it's good to have somebody in your life that can step back and say, wait a minute before you do that. Have you thought about this before you take that next step? You need that voice of reason in your life. Don't walk away from those people that God has assigned to your life. Because if not, if you no longer listen to reason, you'll listen to the words of an adversary that are designed to intimidate you and to leave you feeling hopeless and helpless. Remember our scripture about opposition? Our enemy walks about like a roaring lion seeking whom he may devour. The roar of your adversary is designed to intimidate you. And it's through words. There are people here today, you don't even know it, but you're under a spirit of intimidation. Let me tell you how you can identify it. You feel overwhelmed in your thoughts, in your emotions. You're feeling all of this pressure in your family, in your business. You're feeling all of this pressure in your finances and in your marriage. That may be an indicator to you that the enemy is trying to intimidate you, to make you feel like your life is crashing in. That's what Elijah thought. What's the use? I just want to give up. I want to quit. Just go ahead and kill me now, God. Get it over with. Why? Because he was intimidated. He wasn't listening to the voice of reason. And you will know you're here in this place spiritually. You'll know you're being devoured by these thoughts when all you can think about is those things that are going on, those negative things that are taking place in your life. There's no more joy, it's gone. There's no more peace, it's gone. All hope is lost, and all you can think about is that one thing that you can't seem to get victory over. That's the enemy trying to devour you and intimidate you. But you have to remember, that God has an assignment for your life. You have to remember that God has connected you to people. You have to remember that people have been connected to you. And you have to not listen. You have to drown those voices out that are trying to intimidate you and get you to get off of your assignment and quit. Quit serving God, quit church, quit life. I just want that to sink in. You have to remind yourself, God's for me, and he's not against me. And these things that are happening in my life right now, the fire, the wind, the earthquake, all of these things are a part of what's going on in my life, but God's going to use all of those things, work it together for my good, so that I can continue in the assignment that God has for my life. Now, listen, I'm going to stop here. But I promise you, next week, I'm going to get you out of the cave. I'm going to get people out of dysfunction. God's going to do it. Let me put it this way. That funk that you're in, God's going to show us how to get out of it. That depression that you're facing, that anxiety, that intimidation, I need 40 more minutes to, and I don't think I can get 40 more minutes out of you right now. Y'all look pretty tired, but next week, God's going to get us out of that. How many are ready to get out of it? We're coming out of the cave. I want you to stand. Would you stand with me? Remember the question? We read it twice. It was in the scripture twice, right? What are you doing here? May I just suggest to you that God's not asking him, why are you in this cave? Might I just suggest to you that God is asking Elijah, why are you here? Why are you on this planet? What is your purpose? What is your assignment? I think that's what God's asking him. Go back and remember, Elijah. Remember, I called you. Remember, I anointed you. Remember, I gifted you. Remember, it was me who assigned you to be a prophet to this nation. Why are you here, Elijah? Go back to your why. Go back to your why and you'll find your purpose. You'll find it. You'll discover it. Maybe God's asking you today, why? Why are you here? I told you in the very beginning, if you have a pulse, you have a purpose. You're not a mistake, you're a masterpiece. You have gifts and talents that God's put in you. Not to be withheld, not to hold on to yourself, but to help serve others. To be that missing link in somebody's life. You are more valuable and important than you really realize. It's hard for us to really understand, but if God's work is going to get done on this earth, it's going to get done through us, His people, His church, His body. Be encouraged. Be strengthened. God's going to get you out of that funk. He's going to get you out of that state that you're in right now. He's going to get you out of it. I promise you that. And you will not leave this planet until you fulfill His purpose for your life. Father, we thank You for this blessed day that You have given us, Lord. We don't take it for granted. We don't. We thank You for this opportunity that You've given us to worship You together as the body of Christ. We thank You, Lord, that You are our Heavenly Father. There's none like You. You're a good, good Father. And I just pray, God, right now that You would just resurrect within each and every one of our hearts the assignment and the purpose that You have for our life. And there are those who have yet to discover it. I pray over this process they would begin to discover the purpose, the design for their life. And we'll never cease to give You the praise nor the glory for it. We honor fathers here today. Strengthen them, lead them, bless them, and guide them. And we'll never cease to give You the praise nor the glory for it. In Jesus' mighty name I pray. Amen. And everyone said, amen. Come on, one more time. Put those hands together. Listen, if you need prayer for anything, if you want us to agree with you in prayer, our prayer partners are here right now to agree with you in prayer. I want you to come and pray. They're going to lead us out of the song. I want you to hang out with us in the back here. People have been here helping serve us today, so let's hang out, let's fellowship a little bit together. God bless you. We love you. We'll see you right back here next week at The Point.
So powerful in all You do.